showing up at this time. I am Naman. I work with Genpact in the data science department. So let's get started. So most of you have understood basically what topic we are going to talk in the next like 25 minutes. And for the people who didn't understand, these images would help you. So these are the things that we see in our daily life. It does not take a good, well-educated IT community guy to understand these slides, right? So movies for you, people you may know. Customers who have viewed this have also viewed. Recommendations for you, delivery recommendations for you. There are plethora of recommendation engines that we come across in our daily lives, right? Personalized product recommendation, integral part of today's consumer journey, needless to say. And what are the common approaches that the companies, big companies use to recommend? Told about this before. So the common approaches are collaborative filtering and market basket analysis. And major CPG majors and IT industries use the combination or hybrid of these two approaches to give us the recommendations that we want as consumers nowadays. So this is another method of generating revenue, and other methods that are there for generating revenue are forecasting demand, so that you could bridge the gap between whatever the demand would be and whatever the demand that we are forecasting, right? So machine learning has been used for years in recommendation engines as well, in forecasting as well. So talking a little bit more about the use case, the use case was a publishing company, which was our client, approached us with the problem that they have been facing a lot of churn in their online platform. So you could, online platform which has educational content. So you could think our client as kind of like Coursera, but it had one more catch, that they used to sell their, since they were a publishing company and their core work was to sell books. Right, so they wanted to sell their books on their online platform as well. For that, they wanted to create a recommendation engine. So for it sells book through the online platform. So you can think of it like a Coursera with certain books which are recommended on the side, not the courses. So so since they were facing churn, and by churn I mean unsubscription, if I'm subscribing to a particular if I'm unsubscribing to a particular service online, so that means churn here, right? So for churn management, they wanted us to ask, to answer three questions. Number one, they wanted us to find out the reason that why are they facing churn. Number two, they wanted to forecast the demand. And number three, they wanted us to build a recommendation engine so that they could sell more books online, right? And in this talk, what we are going to focus on is the third part. Is of recommending content, not just content, also books, to our target customers. So what are we working with here? So we have historical data, which is provided by the company. We have 4,500 institutes. We have 657 books and 68 subjects. And the data was rich, I would say. We had a data of about 2.5 to 3 lakh rows with 113 columns, 113 variables, which had details of university names, instructor names, student names, the book titles that people are using, the enrollment details of each and every course on the online platform for 5 years. Right, so we have already discussed a quick recap. We have already discussed about what we are going to discuss here, what is the data that we are working with. Now, since the title, hence the graph database. Since the data that we had was highly connected, we thought of approaching this problem of recommendation through a graph database. Because if you have a connected data, a simple spreadsheet is not the most efficient way to represent or analyze something, right? So graph database offers plenty of options, plenty of other options which a normal spreadsheet software doesn't offer us. So Neo4j was chosen for making this a recommendation engine. Why Neo4j? Because various reasons. Because cipher query language that Neo4j offers is easier to learn, much more easier to learn as compared to other databases which we were considering for choosing this project. So it's a leading graph database. It has shorter queries. So for the people who don't understand what a graph database is, you can think of it like SQL, but SQL which is more visual and which is more visually, which can give you a better visuals like this diagram that you can see here. So this is the primary structure of the database or schema of the database. If there are some people who have basically experience with SQL or no SQL or MongoDB databases, we always have schema there. So this is our basic schema. So as you can see, an instructor teaches a course, and a course is taught in a university, and an instructor could be a professor in a university, right? So this is the model that we created out of these are the three main basic node labels. For the people who don't understand what nodes and edges are, in Excel, Excel spreadsheet, you have cells. Here in Neo4j graph database, we have nodes and lines as edges. So you can understand it like a good representation of data, or nodes are like circles of data and edges are like just lines. And we always have auxiliary tags to attach onto them so that we can use that data as indexes. So you can see here we have a schema which is three nodes and three edges. So this is like the empirical representation of whatever we are working with. So you can imagine our whole data to be a cluster of all of these triangles with proper nouns inserted in the circles and the lines, and all of these are connected in a much highly interconnected level. So heart of the recommendation engine. So till now what we have done is we have discussed whatever data that we are working with, and whatever graph database that we have been using, and how we have not discussed how to use it, because it'll be another talk only. So we have our data imported in graph database right now. Now, how do you generate a particular recommendation engine? So we randomly, the zeroth step would be, we just choose a random particular university to generate recommendations for. When I'm generating recommendations, what am I doing? I'm just generating a list. A list of what? A list of courses. A list of courses and a list of books. By list, I would mean a list of courses and a list of books so that I could recommend those on my online platform to a particular university. And that university would show all of these, basically the whole list to their students. So what do? I choose a particular university and I ask two basic questions. I ask, according to the particular university, what are the universities which are most influential, number one. And number two, I ask, with respect to the particular university, what are the nearby nodes or nearby people who are directly connected to a particular node, right? So I am asking two questions here for recommendations. What is the most influential person or influential entity in the whole network according to that particular university? And number two, who like what is that particular node a part of a community or a subgraph in the plethora of nodes that are available. So two types of algorithms come into play when we are asking these questions. So first algorithm through the use of centrality algorithms that Neo4j already has or already provides, it's embedded in it. So first algorithm is page rank algorithm that we used for centrality or for finding out the influence quotient of a particular node. A node could be anything from these three kinds of labels. A node could be a particular instructor. An instructor could be very influential, or a particular course could be very popular among the data. Among the network, or a particular university could be really popular among the network. So, to find out the influence quotient of a particular node, we used PageRank algorithm, and we use a slightly customized version of PageRank, which was a personalized PageRank. So rather than asking who is the best, I am asking who is the best according to a particular person. So it's kind of like conditional probability, wherein the condition is that I have chosen a particular university to recommend to. So here we are. We have answered the question of that how I am assigning a rank to assigning an influence quotient to everyone, like everyone in the network. So we are doing that through PageRank. So as you can see in the diagram, the bigger, the more the number of relationships or the more the number of outgoing lines a particular circle has, or the more the number of edges a particular node has, the bigger size it is, higher is the PageRank. So you can see that we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 relationships for the center node here in the diagram, and hence the bigger size, hence higher is the page rank there. So this is just for representational purposes. Neo4j assigns a number there, and it does not portray the exact figure. Another question that we wanted to ask, wanted to answer was, what are the nearby nodes for a probe university? So for that, we wanted to identify a particular community, right? A particular community, how do we find it? Technically, we find it through Luwian modularity method here, which is also embedded in Neo4j. You just have to write one line of code, and they would the program, this, basically the database would find all the subgraphs that might be existing. Sorry. So what Luwian modularity does is it has a particular set of parameters to find the modularity of each and every node that is present in the network. By modularity, you can understand modularity as if a particular set of nodes are given a boundary, like here, like there are all of the nodes here are the blue nodes that I'm talking about. We have a boundary around it, right? So if they were assigned a boundary, so the number of relationships these nodes have inside them divided by the number of relationships these nodes have outside them, this quantity is called modularity of a particular community, right? So Luwian modularity does exactly this. Now how to assign the boundary around the nodes, those are just parameters which the algorithm decides. All right. So till now, we have generated recommendation engines through use of Luwian modularity and through community detection and centrality algorithms. Now, the problem that we were getting was since we have like 657 books in our database, we were generating like 400 or 500 books through this method because the data is highly interconnected. So we wanted to fine tune our possibility because it's not possible for a general human being who is going through a website to go through all of 400 or 500 recommendations that we might be giving. So we wanted to fine tune our list that we are generating. So these were the filters or the constraints that we used so that we could fine tune our recommendation engines further. So we removed the cases where account was a particular account. By account, we mean a university or an independent group which is which has a good size to be called as a university. So removal of cases where account lost due to technical glitches in the system. So we had the data of this as well. If there was a churn because of a technical glitch. We had that data. So we removed those cases. So we recommend only the books which have not been used by an account in the past. So there were most of the recommendations that we had was already being used by a particular university for which we were recommending. So we thought this is not the best way to recommend something, and we could not have the complete credit to ourselves if the graph is growing up for the enrollment of a particular recommendation, if that recommendation has already been subscribed by a particular user. So we thought of cross-selling here. What cross-selling what? Again, courses and books. So also we rooted out the recommendation for which we had no data. That is like, I know you must think this should be the preliminary step, but graph database requires a one step further. So this was our third constraint. Now the metric for analysis. We have generated recommendations for everything, like for every university. How do I know that whatever I have generated is good enough? So there was no particular metric which floats around in the market and says, use this metric if in your recommendation engine to figure out basically how good your recommendation engine is. So we had to define our own. So since we have activation data for 5 years, from 2015 to 2019, what we decided to go with the final metric would be the number of successful recommendations divided by the total number of recommendations that I have generated for a particular university. So let's say I have generated 10 recommendations for a particular university that you should subscribe to this course, or you should recommend these books to your students. And if the university was not using those courses or books before, but the university for the same year, I am recommending the list to them now. If the enrollment difference is positive, from zero, it had went to zero, like to a positive number. So we would say that our recommendation was successful. So that is what we meant by a successful recommendation. So our final metric was the number of successful recommendations divided by total number of recommendations that we have given. So the results. How did we do it? So we basically ranked each of the university according to a global page rank, and then we assigned generated recommendations for all the universities. And this is the result that we got: 41, 59, 45. You don't have to bother about the numbers, but because the statement that I will be giving in conclusion would be much more insightful to you that way. So we conclude that the recommendations that we generated were very insightful, this is the most important statement that I wanted to make. So if we recommend two products to you, in this case, for this subset, if we recommend two, on an average, you would subscribe one as a consumer, which is a very good number. As compared to the number that floats around in the market for the recommendation engines, according to some sources. Apart from importing the data, the process is very easy. It's not like you have to do some kind of modeling, a hardcore modeling, like you need to run various deploy reinforcement learning methods or deep QN networks to achieve same kind of things. But it was just a few lines of cipher query language data query, and boom, here you go. I would generate a list of recommendations for like next to nothing. Yeah, so connected data can be used efficiently with the graph database that we have seen through this use case. And we have just used this graph database for just a particular use case, and we would say that this could be used like in many many domains, other domains as well. So you have CPG, you have healthcare, you have social media networks, wherein presently these graph database are used, right? Yeah, so thank you. Questions, if any?
I have around per month the 1 million of record. If I go for the 1 year of last, it will be 12 millions to scale. I have to recommend the recommendation for that. It's basically cost use case, the how much in the forecasting side.
Okay, so the size of your data would be around?
It's like 12 millions 1 year. 12 millions for 1 year.
1 million for 1 year?
No, 1 million for 1 month.
One month, okay. Yeah. So I would say you would generate around 12 million, or let's say, suppose safely we would say 15 million of data, 15 million rows, can say that.
Yeah,
so Neo4j is highly scalable for that. You just need the infrastructure, okay. And you just need the right modeling, okay, to traverse through the graph. If you see, we made a very simple empirical relationship. If you increase the number of relationships,
okay,
if you increase the number of types of nodes, mm-hmm, the harder your schema is, or the more complicated your schema is, harder it will be for the computer, or basically the whole infrastructure, to traverse through the graph.
Okay.
So you have to make sure of two things. Basically, you have to have good infrastructure, and you have to have a good model, basically.
Okay.
Yeah. It's highly scalable. It's presently used by major CPG majors.
Okay.
Also.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yeah. Thanks.
You mentioned that you were tracking the recommendation, which turned into typical conversion, right?
No, I did not mention that. Can you please rephrase that?
The successful recommendations, you were tracking them across. For the unsuccessful ones,
yes.
How was the model learning back?
No, there's no learning here. There's no conventional learning here.
Okay.
So the two algorithms that we are using here are PageRank and community detection. So we have connected data. So what machine learning, generally what we do is we put down the models, and then machine learning has to figure out all the parameters in between. Right? Here are the parameters when we have connected data. Here the parameters are already there. So you don't have to figure it out. So what we are doing here is using that connected data as our source, so that machine learning does not have to figure out those.
So there is no closed learning typically.
Closed learning here. Okay. Yes. Hence, it's an easy way. Yeah.
So how are the weights between the links getting decided here for each of the communities?
Yeah, that is what Luwain modularity does. What it does is it randomly assigns a particular number of nodes, a particular community ID. So for let's say suppose initially the algorithm decides that you have 5 nodes, and we would divide the whole graph in 5 nodes. And then we would check the modularity of the same. Could you get a better modularity? If not 5, then 6. This is an iterative process which the algorithm does. So what it does is it randomly assigns the number first, and then checks it until you have reached a threshold.
Yes. Yeah. Excuse me. Hello. Yeah.
Yeah.
So you mentioned about the recommendations using the graph database, but there is something new concept comes with the graph theory. In the algorithm level, we can use the graph theory for recommendations. Is it possible?
I did not understand your question. Please, can you repeat?
Yeah, no, you mentioned that the recommendation using the graph database.
Yeah,
in the graph database, you are mentioning using the graph.
Yes.
So in the model itself, we can use the graph theory. So the new concept comes like a graph theory.
Yes.
We can use it graph theory using for the recommendation engine.
No
recommendation.
Yes, that is what the thing is. Our graph database uses graph theory only. So okay. To traverse the graph, we have certain rules which, or certain, I should say, advantageous relationships, how to traverse through the graph. Okay. So we have using we are using in a graph database, particular graph theory is only used being used. So we don't have to take like take care of that part.
Okay.
So whatever it is, it's already graph theory.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah.
Do you have any other? Hi, here. Do you, I mean, right now you've provided the list of courses that a university should list and the kind of books that they should use for these courses. How about the talent needed to teach these courses? And if not the talent needed, maybe the trainings, additional trainings required for the lecturers or the professors to get in order to, you know, be able to teach this, like as an additional use case that you could use.
Yeah, that could be used, but what I am recommending here is the recorded data that we already have there in on the online platform. So this is this recommendation was a video recommendation of the courses. So basically, I have a master data which is stored with the client, and that data is recorded only. So by talent, I'm assuming that you mean the professors or whosoever would be the instructors, right?
Correct.
So instructors have already recorded the data in a video format. And what I'm doing is I am taking those videos and deciding my target audience. And then I am subjecting them to these recommendations so that they might find these useful. Okay. Yeah.
Quick.
Ensure the local dependency.
No, the course. See, the course is not. And see, we have a subscription. For example, if we have a content which is recorded, we are given that the content would not be taken off without our permission. So the first question is taken care of. Second question, could you please repeat?
So there will be like, you know, you mentioned about central limit theorem, right? So in context to that.
No, not central limit theorem. It was a centrality algorithm.
Okay, to yes. Identify the subnet and as well as the dependent nodes which is connected to the probe, right? That's what.
Let me rephrase that. Mm-hmm. When I'm using a centrality algorithm, I want to find out what is the biggest influencer in a particular network. You can think of it like a social media network, and I'm finding celebrities here. So by through PageRank, I'm finding those. And what is the criteria that I am applying here to find out the influences? Larger the number of relationships a particular node has, higher is the influence quotient.
How it dynamically adds the, like, you know, details. Let's say a course will be, you know, added each and every now and then, right?
Yes. Drawback of the use case that we had, because we did not have daily data. We had chronological data for 5 years.
Can't you pick up graphical models where it will, like, you know, Markov in and all, like, you know, Bayesian and all?
No, we can do that. But we can do that. But the thing is ki we would recommend it. We would recommend using the daily data. But how about how do I judge then what is the metric? Right. So to come up with a metric, we had to simplify it further down. Yeah.
Thank you.
Myself Shubhrata here. So my question is that as you mentioned that it's a kind of not conventional machine learning model, right? It's
yes.
Not a train and test.
Yes.
So my question is that how you are refresh your data, how frequently you are doing the refreshment of your data?
We would refresh it as per the client requirement. The client wanted us to have a good 1 year recommendation for future. Right, and the client would play around with the parameters, and some recommendations would be for some time in a year would be higher than a particular time, and there are plenty of parameters that a client could play around. So we wanted to give them a whole bunch of your recommendations. Okay. Yeah.
And my second question is that is this support the multi-tenancy support? For example, same model or. To support the different universities or something like that? Multi-tenant?
I did not understand. Please rephrase it.
I mean, multi-tenant support is there? in this graph whatever the model you presented?
Okay, so what I got from your question is that if I'm recommending...
Is it scalable or something like that?
Yeah, it's definitely scalable.
For multi-tenant?
Yeah, sure. Okay. Why not? Okay. You can do that. It's fine, I can hear you, yeah.
Right now the recommendations are thrown at the node level or for the next group or a university.
So can we scale to throw recommendations to student level based on their subject?
See, what we are doing here, we are giving a list of recommendations to a particular university. The university decides what to do with it, whether they want those recommendations to be given to instructors or the influencers in their small graph, or whether they want that list to directly reach to the students. So what we are recommending here, courses and books. To whom we are recommending? Universities or big accounts. How does that reach to the students or the consumer level is their job.
Yeah. So right now the model does not reach till the end user. So
it can, yeah, it's like the finishing step or the polishing of the shoe, you can say. The shoe is already being made. Whatever the useful recommendations would be for a particular university and the students and the instructors of a university, we have generated that. Now you can give that to anyone. You would obviously increase revenue with these recommendations.
Thank you.
Yeah.